It's a pleasure to come along and speak at this today. I'm Ross Isdale. I'm a senior associate with the Challenges Group. So we are Scotland's largest independent development agency. We've been around since 1999 and mainly provide management consultancy and advisory services with a focus on maximising enterprise potential to deliver extraordinary impact globally. And nearly 25 years down the line, we've worked in over 70 countries. We've supported more than 4,000 small and medium-sized enterprises. And you know, this could be through a range of advisory work or program work too, with backing from a broad range of different partners, ranging from the Scottish Government to the Chartered Management Institute and to Standard Chartered Foundation through their Future Makers program. And today, just my plan is to share some reflections just based on our experience in supporting a broad range of different startups, enterprises, and other types of organizations that have a social mission or are purpose-driven and are seeking to internationalize largely into the Southern Hemisphere. But I think, you know, regardless of, you know, where these reflections have come from, I think that they absolutely are still relatable and still should be considered regardless of the territory entered into. And I'm also really interested to hear your own thoughts too, you know, whether you are from an enterprise perspective or, you know, currently an ideation stage or, you know, as a support and ecosystem enabling perspective as well. So I'd like to just take a second to introduce where internationalization and venture building and the support that the Challenges offers through one of its work streams, how that fits into the broader ISEO vision, you know, especially supporting Scottish-based innovation to internationalize into, you know, the global south. And in its current form, our support in this strand is funded by the Scottish Government, and we are calling it the Social Enterprise Internationalisation Infrastructure Programme, which, as I said, really at its core is enabling Challenges to actively recruit, build and support and financially back as well innovative Scottish-based enterprises to internationalise and achieve global impact, you know, especially within the Southern Hemisphere. And this builds on a previous program that we also ran in partnership with the Scottish Government called the Access Africa program, again, which focused on Scottish social enterprises and social entrepreneurs and helping them to explore and expand into African markets. So we are providing market research and business development support to enterprises and individuals who have an idea, product, service, or model that could make real impact within the Southern Hemisphere. And, you know, overall, the SIEP, as we call it, the platform, we are hoping to prove that Scotland's knowledge, intellectual property, and our real commitment to social, economic, and environmental justice absolutely does have a place to deliver strong impact, as well as commercial viability globally. And so we're aiming to place social enterprise principles at the core and really to demonstrate to other forms of business how they can marry commercial growth and social impact to achieve inclusive growth. We are integrated within Scotland's existing business support and development community infrastructure. And we are, as I said, offering market access support as well as other forms of funding for internationalization. And as Naomi said as well, proactively bringing opportunities from the Southern Hemisphere to Scotland as well. And I want to start off around the foundations for achieving international impact and commercial viability and, you know, really focusing on mindset. And I hope that these reflections don't sound negative. They're not supposed to. You know, we do hope that they are constructive and, you know, are leading to stronger, more impactful outcomes in the future. And, you know, I think everybody on this call knows that in Scotland, we are really lucky to have a very large pool of highly skilled, highly tenacious and talented people that have a strong desire to use their knowledge and skills to do good internationally and to achieve global impact. And, you know, at its best, we see great success, you know, from those building impactful ventures. And they're coming from those who really have an intimate experience, but also take a bird's eye view of very often complex problems. And they do have, as I said, that insatiable need to overcome them. And, you know, so they already inherently have a very strong understanding of who or what is affected by the challenges that they're currently seeing, what's holding current broken systems in place, who stands to benefit or lose out if the problem is solved. You know, also things like what are the current and prior solution efforts, what has already been tried, what's worked well, what hasn't, and how are these potential solution efforts actually being connected. And this has allowed them to successfully identify the gaps and to really build on previous lessons and attempts and learn from them. And this absolutely isn't to say that only those who have lived experience of complex challenges should be the only ones to start new ventures focusing on achieving global impact. But I mean, we believe it certainly means that those who don't have that have a real responsibility to surround themselves with the right type of people, with the right experience to generate insight responsibly. And, you know, I think we'll get onto that with our speakers. But really, this insight allows for the creation of innovations that are actually suited for the context. And where, I guess, we've seen difficulties in creating impactful ventures in the past, more often than not, we see that, I guess, that desire to achieve global impact, it isn't necessarily coming from this intimate understanding of the problem. Instead, the desire might be motivated by a host of other reasons. For, you know, for instance, people might have earned good money in an industry with certain negative reputations. It could be to fulfill personal reasons and, you know, looking for a sense of adventure internationally. And even then, more extrinsic reasons like validation among peers, unfortunately. And for those people, sometimes we do see, we do see that there is an inability to actually precisely pinpoint the exact opportunity to achieve impact, and an underestimation of the difficulties of creating an enterprise that's actually equipped to understand the problem and then to contribute to solving it. And I think that we as ecosystem enablers, we really need to build an infrastructure where these innovators are supported really from the outset to understand the development challenges they'd like to solve before, you know, they're spending months and months or years designing products, services, and models. And, you know, forcing people from the outset to spend time defending ideas that haven't been validated, and then giving them pitch training to make those ideas sound really compelling, will inevitably lead to a kind of confirmation bias. And, you know, we've seen entrepreneurs who weren't so sure about their idea before entering into, for example, a competition where they had to really defend their ideas so compellingly, you know, they then convince themselves that they're onto something. And once something or once someone has actually married to that idea, especially if they then receive funding for it and they have to go out and try it, it's then a lot less likely that they're then going to go back and to test you know, the fundamental assumptions about the problem that they're really trying to solve. So I think a lot of ecosystem players are beginning to reflect on this and, you know, what causes this scenario where entrepreneurs who don't have lived experience and also won't rely on other means to get to grips with what the problems are on a really complex level, you know, within the local environment. You know, and I think one interesting thing that I found by a woman who works at Oxford's Said Business School, Daniela Pappy Thornton, her name is. And she thinks it could be something to do with the Dunning-Kruger effect, which is a really well-known and proven cognitive bias. It essentially says that when somebody is just beginning to get to grips with a topic that interests them, they tend to rate themselves very highly in that area. But I guess it's only once you start to learn a bit more about the topic, only then realizing that it was harder than they first thought. And, you know, we've often seen through our work in supporting internationalization, this kind of idea. And what it ultimately manifests in is an unwillingness to, first off, devote sufficient time, resources, energy towards first knowing what, I guess, the sources of information are available or required to actually understand both where the solutions are needed and where they can add value, as well as what the correct models are for addressing you know, these problems and what they need to look like within the context. There's also an underestimation of the value of building solid national and international networks and partnerships that are needed. As I was saying before, the program that we ran before, the Access Africa program, one of the key learnings from the 40 to 45 organizations that we support during that program was that successful internationalization of innovation absolutely requires entrepreneurs to really fully embrace a collaborative multi-stakeholder approach. There is this critical need to pull together the experience and the expertise domestically and internationally from across academia, different value chain players, non-governmental organizations, startups, technical experts, and even, you know, corporations who can help clear a path to market for high impact products and services. And the facilitation of those linkages to these different types of ecosystem players, that's absolutely a fundamental part of our CIET program, as well as the wider vision and objectives of ISEO as a whole. And then number three as well, it also finally leads to the selection, entering and expansion into you know, new markets, really with little understanding and almost an over-reliance on personal preferences dictating the role that these organizations want to play within the market, rather than understanding from a market-centric perspective what it actually needs. And when you're looking at this from a commercial sustainability perspective, what we ultimately see is the creation of unsustainable business models, as entrepreneurs have difficulties in designing new products or services that are actually fit for delivering global impact. They'll have difficulties in offering prices to clients that they actually are able to pay and on terms that are actually manageable. We'll see difficulties in meeting institutional needs within these markets, especially from you know, regulatory bodies, or, you know, from a cultural legitimacy perspective, you know, we'll really see them struggling to meet the needs of these different institutions. We'll see difficulties in establishing and using distribution channels and tapping into value chains that will actually complement their offering, as well as we'll see difficulties in offering technical and after-sales service, and difficulty in adjusting promotional activities to be relevant to the local market context. And the picture there, I think, really represents this idea. And this is something called an oxygen concentrator graveyard. You know, and these oxygen concentrators made their way into the Malawian market. And these weren't designed to meet the needs of the Malawian health sector from a design, a supply chain, and an after sales service perspective. And so what really happened was that inevitably when these systems developed faults, because they weren't built for the rugged conditions that are actually needed, and instead of there being an availability of components and spare parts and the supply of trained technicians who are actually equipped to deal with the faults, what happened was instead that they were just cast aside, really never to be used again. So just the perfect example for me of, you know, this kind of idea where we really need to be ensuring that we understand that the internationalization process is complex, and we need to surround ourselves with the correct people and organizations with the right information. And finally, I just like, you know, as I said, perhaps on the first slide, we do in Scotland live in a time when there is this, almost this kind of hyper expectation that everybody needs to be an entrepreneur. That's where all the funding opportunity is. And for startup social enterprises, that kind of immediate assumption is that if you're a founder of an organization, you're also expected to be the chief executive officer. And, you know, that can be sometimes a very costly assumption to make. Social entrepreneurs start with an idea and they fuel it with passion, really, to create this systemic change. But that doesn't necessarily speak to the broader skill set of a chief exec that really needs to start and grow a successful social enterprise, especially one focused on creating impact and commercial viability internationally. That really demands a global mindset. And so as well as your usual C-suite traits like, you know, senior leadership and communication skills, strategic thinking and foresight, delegation and, you know, employee development, these types of CEOs are able to use their cross-cultural knowledge skillfully to develop context-specific strategies. They're able to really importantly bridge differences in a meaningful way by actively managing these differences between people, values and culture. They also play a really important coordinating role, more than a kind of controlling one. And really they spend most of their time and resources improving cooperation between the various elements of their international system that they've created. And, you know, we've often seen that many founders have talents in creating innovative ideas, modeling concepts and, you know, developing new technologies. You know, they're usually people who really get their energy from problem solving and modeling and creating. Whereas, you know, chief execs, on the other hand, need long-term energy, possessing a vision and an attention to detail to ensure that, you know, there is this maximum speed towards growth while not burning out, obviously, before the finish line. And it could be that the founder's strengths lie within advising chief execs, you know, not necessarily being one. So I'm not going to go on, you know, too much longer, but it really, in summary, I'd just like to get to the heart of what I'm trying to say with these slides. And I really think it boils down to these three questions. You know, are we starting impact ventures with international scope for the right reason? Are we ensuring that we are building our international models on the right information? And are we building the right skill set to maintain the role of chief exec within an internationalized organization? So I'm just going to leave it there. And I'm now just going to hand over to our two speakers who are going to do a Q&A session with us. So if you can bear with me just for a second. If I could hand over to Mark Anderson first, and I'm really just looking for 5 minutes at the beginning here, just explain who you are, what your background is, and how you're connected to Scotland's internationalisation venture scene as well. So if I could hand over to Mark first, if that's okay.
Thanks very much, Ross. So just to introduce myself, I'm Director of Research and Innovation at Glasgow Caledonian University. And I think it's fair to say that at least strategically, Glasgow Caledonian University has really consciously positioned itself to aspire to be world leading in social innovation. And what that means, obviously, depending on who you are, is different interpretations. But for us, for a number of years, one of the things that we were very keen on doing was looking at how we could work in other regions across the world, and specifically to look at how we could establish environments within universities that would support social entrepreneurship, social innovation, social enterprise, both through student entrepreneurship programs, but also through their knowledge exchange and the relationships they build. So in 2015, we established a Latin American social innovation network with 8 universities in Colombia, Panama, Brazil, and Chile. And really the idea and what we did with them and with European funding was to help them establish social innovation support units, which would work very much like, say, a research and innovation unit within the university, an innovation unit within the university, but that was specifically geared towards social innovation, working with its communities and trying to establish a way of driving social innovation within the ecosystem. We replicated that project in Southeast Asia, in Thailand, Myanmar, Malaysia, and Cambodia. And again, working with universities, but also with stakeholders within the ecosystem there to try and establish very similar units as we did in Latin America. We've gone on to do something similar as well in Europe through another project, Social Innovation Through Knowledge Exchange, with partners in Spain, Portugal, Germany, and Croatia. And we have several other projects geared more towards social entrepreneurship, social enterprise. And I see Lalith is here, and we seem to coincide quite a lot lately, but he was involved in a project that we also worked with challenges, basically looking at setting up similar units for supporting social enterprise in Sri Lanka, doing the same in Vietnam. We've done various projects of that ilk. I think that for us, it's always been mostly about setting up the environments and working with the institutions to set up the environments, and not working directly with the social entrepreneurs themselves. The idea is to prepare the universities to be able to do that. And obviously, especially in the last few years when I've become Director of Research and Innovation, is doing the same within Glasgow Caledonian University. What does that look like? How do we turn the university inside out, bring people in? How do we encourage our students to become social entrepreneurs? And does that differ to normal entrepreneurship programs, and how does that differ? And then the whole question of how we can work across borders with that. And I think that's probably enough for the time being, Ross, unless you want me to talk about anything else.
No, that's perfect, Mark. Thanks very much. And Maya, if I could come to you as well.
Thank you. Hi, everybody. My name is Mia Perry, and I co-lead the Sustainable Futures Global Network, was a co-founder as well of this network. I actually could put the link in the chat. I'll do that in a minute. I live in Scotland now. My background is in the arts sector. I started off in theatre in Ireland and Canada, various places, and I moved into academia, and then I to get a PhD, and I started that sort of traditional academic route, teaching arts education. And then I left academia and moved into an international NGO sector, in search of a more sort of direct and what I felt at the time straightforward relationship with social change, and found myself through that back in academia again. So now I'm a professor of arts and literacies education at the University of Glasgow as my day job. And I began that work in the School of Education at Glasgow about 7.5-8 years ago now. And it was actually that role that invited my work that was quite international and that was quite cross-sector. They really invited me to bring that work to the center of my role at the university as an academic once again. I suppose just in a 5-minute summary of why I now am moving into a new sector again, the social enterprise sector, is that I began my career chapter at the University of Glasgow with UKRI funding to establish a strategic network. It's specifically a funding program called strategic networking, I think. And one of the first things I achieved at the university was raise money to build a strategic network around questions of sustainability as they related to education, because arts and education was my area of expertise. And I did that internationally. And that was 7 years ago now. And when I started that work on behalf of the University of Glasgow, really, I was really determined at that very early stage in re-entering academia to do that, to carry out that work in a way that was going to challenge a status quo of international development related research from the global north, claiming and conceptualizing problems in other places and benefiting from the research outcomes and the research outputs and the research income. And so I started that network. It was quite small at the time, around 16, 17 people, with a really explicit critique of the development industry over the past 100 years, and with a really explicit narrative that the world isn't getting any better with increasing funds going to increasing funds channeled towards development related work, whether it's in the NGO sector or in the GCRF and international research sector. My colleagues and friends that I had known across sectors and across my career were very quick to tell me that their communities weren't better off than they were 50 years ago. We know that our environmental sustainability is certainly not any better off than it was 50 years ago. And we look at all sorts of social and ecological fragmentation that isn't better, but that is worse in many respects than it was before the surge of interest and funding towards international development related research. So 7 years ago, I started a research network with a collective commitment with a small group of people that we were going to work differently. We were going to experiment. We didn't know how to work equitably and sustainably, but we were going to really try by not just moving along the well-oiled tracks of academic careers and international research partnerships. And what happened over the, and today we're in 2023, so what's happened since 2016-17 is that in order to do that, equitable partnership practices became really core to all of our work. We didn't go into that network as partnership experts. We went in as educationalists, as ecologists, as development workers. Some of us were farmers and teachers, but we became experts in how to navigate cross-cultural, cross-sector, cross-geographical partnerships in equitable ways. And that's been really, really hard to do. It's but really, really rewarding. The network is now over 150 people. And about a year ago, we every year of that network, we have had to rethink on a very strategic high level how to maintain a network that is equitable and sustainable whilst working within the constraints of institutions and development organizations and charities and schools. And to do that, we've had to live in the margins in between sectors really quite a lot. And about a year ago, we decided to become independent, the network to become an independent entity in itself, in and of itself, to allow us to continue to respond and create and enact ethical, equitable, sustainable ways of working together across many, five African hubs currently, and two in South Asia and two in Europe, and growing hubs in Latin America as well. And that journey led us to work with Ross and the Challengers Group. And I think we'll have opportunities to talk over the next hour about some of the joys and the challenges of this process. But I've already learned a great deal in the past half an hour, so I don't really feel like I'm an expert, but I'm a sort of a living example of someone who is really committed to the promise and the potential of a social enterprise model from the background of both NGO and academic leadership roles. I'm really committed to it and really humbled by the complexity of it, but committed to the promise and the purpose of doing that work. So that's me.
Thanks very much, Mina. And I think you're both, I'm going to ask this question to you both, because I think that you're both absolutely qualified to be answering. We've talked a lot, or in my presentation, I was talking about Obviously, this appreciation of building, you know, partnerships and a need for founders and chief execs of startups to appreciate the role that, that partnerships play in collecting data and understanding very complex problems, you know, to you know, on a systemic level. And so I'm just wondering, Mark, if I could start with you, and you know, for you both to answer, what have you learned in your role in bridging cultural differences to enable innovation processes, or to kind of contribute to solving complex problems? And if you have any examples as well of, you know, when people have ignored cultural or contextual differences and just tried to impose ideas on a location or a community, you know, and what was the consequence of that? Or if you've got a good example of the other way around from that. But yeah, thanks.
There are quite a few things in there. So I think probably for me, the most surprising thing that I've learned over the years, and it's a, I think it's absolutely crucial, is to understand that this idea of exchange rather than kind of exporting or imposing a system onto another system. And so it's extremely important to really get to know your partners, and that challenge of intercultural competence. You know, a prime example in my context is that so we were running projects in Latin America, say, and we were going there obviously with European money, so that suddenly made us kind of you know, somebody who would be welcomed and open to our ideas. But I quickly realized that Latin American universities, for example, have very, very well developed civic engagement strategies and are very much more involved with their local communities than European universities. So very often what we were looking at was a situation where we could learn a lot from them. And I think it's really important to, where I think whatever project that you're going to, is that you should be in listening mode. And, you know, I think this applies to whether we're talking about complex ecosystems and the kind of projects we were doing, or individuals. And I mean, this is an anecdote that was told to me, and actually I repeated it once, and she was in the audience and let me know that I'd stolen her anecdote, but I don't think she's in the audience this time, so I'll kind of safely say it again. But it's a quite a nice example of amongst students, and the danger of creating these wonderful social entrepreneurship projects with students, and students have the energy and the interest in creating a project, but very often they miss the important side of doing the research and understanding the communities they're working with. And this example was a project in Ireland where a bunch of students were helping refugees and helping their insertion into society. And so they created a project where the refugees would create knitted products and would then they could then commercialize them. And after some months, one of the refugees turned around to one of the students and said, "You do realize I'm a qualified lawyer, don't you?" And I think there's this kind of, we have like stereotypes, and we have unfortunate kind of attitudes that are created by the situation. And I think that just the other additional thing I would say, and this is something that really worries me, and I think Mia's comment about development projects, and I think it's really interesting. One of the big problems I think we face is that they're always predicated on and structured around an amount of funding and a time frame. And from the beginning, you're thinking about that. And however much the funders talk about sustainability, you're thinking about that 3-year period that you're developing the project. And I think perhaps not enough kind of measures are put in place by the funders to ensure projects are truly sustainable. So follow-up from the funders to ensure they've had quality of results, and that money's continued to be to have an impact, and that there's a real interest in something that's permanent rather than a three-year project. And I think that's one of the biggest dangers in terms of the way we've been working.
Yeah, thanks very much, Mark. And Mia, if I could come to you, just the same question around lessons learned around what role does bridging cultural differences actually play in enabling that innovation process or contributing to solving really complex problems?
Thanks, Ross. I agree with all of Mark's comments, really. And it is a huge question. So I think the challenge for me in this question is where to approach it. I think what I'll do is just give one example. I think probably the group in this room already have examples coming out of their ears of well-intentioned and failed initiatives. And I think that it's really important to acknowledge that that's not just, they're not great for anecdotes, but they really they have huge costs. So one example of that really, really recently is we did a lot of work, as many of you probably did, through the COVID pandemic. And it was quite early on in one of our COVID response projects that we realized that the translation for a face mask in Luganda, in one of the communities we work with in northern Uganda, the closest translation they had was a scarecrow. And that it was it any wonder that people were really reluctant to putting on, to wearing and suddenly accommodating face masks when there was no language to mitigate what the policy directive was, what the global directive was around what this thing meant in discourses in the local community. And I think I've also been involved in many sort of global health campaigns where we talk about weight loss in relation to a context where weight is actually a status of power, and weight is a status of wealth. And there are just hundreds of these, and I don't think we probably don't need to give all of the examples. You already gave one, Ross, at the beginning of the oxygen machines that lie wasted on the sidelines. But I think in terms of embracing and recognizing the role of cultural difference in well-intentioned collective initiatives, I think that language, two things that I think I am really interested in and I find really central to our work and our challenges are language and faith. And I think that they really speak quite easily to the generalizations of working in a place like Scotland and working in a sub-Saharan African country, for example. And I think when we start to take for granted English language, a huge amount of things are misunderstood, are misdirected, are wasted, and cause harm instead of good, or cause unintended consequences. And again, lots of examples, but early on in our work in the network, I had some important conversations with colleagues about this word future even. And someone said to me, when you talk about future, you're talking about, when I talk about future, Mia, I talk about seven generations. I grew up in Ireland and Canada where we're talking about generations to come and how we have to bear thought and attention and commitment to generations beyond us. And my colleagues in Malawi at the time were trying to explain to me, when you say future, we're thinking about 3 months' time. We're thinking about the next harvest cycle. Our future is the next harvest cycle. And so that's why I'm not planting a tree. That's why I'm planting a tomato, because that's my future. So we were using this word future, but we were talking about completely different things, which have completely different needs and implications. And that happens again and again to this day. I try my very best to work translingually and we work across languages as explicitly as we can. But unless we constantly check ourselves, the language carries huge amounts of power that goes unchecked because we assume English, we assume the language of the budget holder, and that can cause, I think, really long-term and deep problems. And the other one, just as an example, I think is faith. And again, coming from a UK perspective, UK, we have a Scottish hub of the network, and our Scottish hub are actually relatively uncomfortable talking about faith. Then we're not guided by faith practices. People have various faith practices from being religious to being atheist and none at all. And because we are in the Scottish hub, not really familiar, comfortable, or interested in dealing with faith practice or the issues of God very much in our day-to-day work, it's easy to forget that actually that's the biggest piece of driving, motivating, infrastructural resourcing systems with many of the communities that we work in. And I think that's, and then that can actually be a place of cultural disrespect. It can be an oversight, it can be a waste, it can be harmful. And it takes a lot of trust and partnership to enter into issues like the words that we speak and pretend to understand, or the God that we believe in, or what gets us up in the morning, which, you know, connects with value systems. So I'm going to conclude by saying that one of the promises, and this connects with Mark, with where you ended, one of the promises and my enthusiasms for the social enterprise model is that within an independent entity, we don't have to be bound by institutional or economic timelines or expectations or needs or demands. We can, I like to think, define them ourselves. So as you were saying, Mark, like, we don't have to stick to the 3-year project cycle, and we don't have to produce all of our outcomes and our reporting through the English language in this particular structure. With the independent model of the social enterprise promises, we can define the timelines and the parameters, the acceptable languages, and the acceptable locations of work in a way that I think allows us to maintain equitable longer term partnerships. The schools are on strike. That was my children. I'm sorry. I'm going to mute now.
Thanks very much, Mia. And if I can come on to, so we're talking about the idea of a social entrepreneur relies heavily on the partnerships that it can create to better understand the complex challenges and what role, for example, Scottish innovation can actually play in solving some of these complex challenges that operate usually in a system. And because there is that reliance on partners to collect that information, to build up that knowledge that's going to allow them to achieve impact, I'm wondering from both of you, if you have any hints or tips for any social innovators or social entrepreneurs on the call, and how they can actually work in equal partnerships. You know, how does this approach actually lead to stronger partnerships and better business as well? But first, you know, how can you ensure that you are building equal partnerships, both for initial understanding of problems, but then also, you know, to complement the innovation that the entrepreneurs are actually trying to bring to the system in place? So I'll start with Mark again. Thanks.
Yeah, well, I think I'm going to kind of borrow from Mia's kind of starting point of the faith and the language, because I think it's a great sort of probably central point, and where I think it's very important to start. And the dangers of that are probably not obvious. So, for example, I think very often, in order to work with another organization, we very often gravitate to people who have the same, who are proficient at English, or have a similar kind of attitudes or values than ourselves. And I think it is a real danger that then you're missing a whole kind of cohort of people because you have this kind of lack of understanding at a cultural level. So I think that because of that, I think that, and obviously I would say it, wouldn't I, Ross, that I think universities are really good kind of pipeline for this. The reason being, I think that what you want to do is you want to find a shared space, kind of mentally and not just physically, where you kind of understand that your challenges and what you're dealing with. And I think the fact that universities exist in all these countries and they have their ecosystems around them, I think is a really, really excellent starting point, which is why I guess we first thought of, you know, how we might be able to engage with other universities and what that might look like. Obviously, the important thing is that we're engaging with the universities, but with our various ecosystems and carrying them through. And that's why, you know, both Mia and I are talking about challenges as a very, very good vehicle for this, as a way of kind of, sort of joining up those dots. But I think that for me, that's absolutely crucial, is that you find a space where you're being inclusive, but you're also understanding each other. And I think that academia and technologies and all the different aspects of academic life help us create that entrance point. And I think that would be my kind of biggest piece of advice. And that's not kind of self-promotion. I really, really believe that's a great way to kind of enter. And the other thing, of course, is that universities in general, at least, are honest brokers. So that their interest is not kind of hampered. You know, obviously, in certain areas, it's hampered. But really, that there's a kind of a position that universities have within countries where they're trusted partners and they have direct links to the ecosystem.
Thanks very much. And Mia, if I could come to you as well, just around tips on how to work in an equal partnership.
Thanks, Ross. Okay, quite briefly, I would say, in addition to everything that's already been said, I think being able to be really clear and self-aware about who on earth we are in that partnership, where we're coming from. So just a level of self-awareness about our own motivations and assumptions and value systems. And that's easy to say, and maybe that's really accessible for everybody here. But for many people, that's a bit of piece of work in itself. Who do you think you are, really, I think, is a really important step, and who we are accountable to. And I think to be able to have that awareness when you're working across such differences is probably the beginning. It's the most, maybe the less exciting and the most difficult part, is to recognize our positionality in that equation. And to recognize why we are there. And once you start to do that work, you realize the differences and the conflict sometimes, and then therefore, hopefully, the common ground. So the quick answer is self-awareness. And that, you know, that often sometimes that connects with universities, and sometimes that can be a strength, and sometimes that can be a weakness. But that might connect to financial motivations. It might be cultural. It might be misconceptions. So self-awareness, who do we think we are? Who are we accountable to? You know, often people will think they're accountable to their lands, to their families, to their gods, to their governments, to their wives, whatever it is. And based on those two things, why are we here? And that does a lot of the work.
Absolutely. Yeah, I think from a lot of what we've seen, and again, coming back to this, this woman, Daniela Pappy Thornton, as well, and she talks about a concept called heropreneurship. And often there will be social entrepreneurs, very well intentioned, who, you know, are receiving funds to work on their project, where I guess the stakes aren't necessarily very high for themselves. You know, this, as I said, they might have some sort of you know, motivation which is built in, you know, adventure, rather than it being this kind of insatiable need to solve, you know, a challenge. And so going in with that kind of mindset, when you're looking at data collection and partnerships, it isn't really based on anything that's particularly, you know, yeah, I don't think long-term necessarily is within their vision in the first instance, and they'll be making promises about, for example, what their technology actually could be solving and, you know, what they're trying to achieve. They're building the relationships based on this, and, you know, there's an element of trust there that's going to happen, but in reality, you know, it isn't necessarily something that they have any real intentions beyond the length of the project to actually to create. And so there's a lot of time and resources put on in-country expertise, which is really the value that's being created, you know, just over the lifespan of the project. And, you know, for one reason or another, a lot of these projects don't actually create social enterprises and become, you know, or achieve the impact that they have set up and told everybody that they're wanting to achieve. And so there's a lot of missed promises there. There's a lot of trust that's been built up and then demolished, you know, just based on this kind of system that's created. And so I think that a lot of social entrepreneurs really need to be careful about establishing these partnerships and making promises and, you know, ensuring that, I guess, they are equitable as well. You know, considering all the value and the knowledge that's been created, I think there needs to be reciprocity to make sure that, you know, both, it is mutually beneficial for both sides of the party when, you know, all this information is being gathered and shared and expertise from in-country to social entrepreneurs. So I think that's just something that a lot of entrepreneurs need to possibly be aware of. If I go on to just more individual questions then, Mark, if I could come back to you, you've touched on this a little bit in terms of the role that GCU can actually play in setting up international networks to support innovation. Can you speak a little bit to that?
Yeah, I think the one thing that to underline, and maybe a caveat to my last question, is that we've we've approached this as a kind of a horizontal unit within the university. So in other words, we don't come in with a particular technology or science that we're trying to evolve. So what we're interested in is talking to our peers within the universities that we're working with. And I think that that's quite important, because I think that what we're trying to do is trying to create an infrastructure where more collaborations can happen. And so that's very important. I think having said everything before, there's a horrible reality that when you do a project, especially when there's money attached, and you're trying to convince people to be involved in this project, how you do that and how you avoid having people who are involved in the project simply because there's money attached to it and don't really know what it's about. Very often the money is almost like an initial carrot, but actually what you achieve has nothing to do with the money that was put in. It's much more to do with the buy-in and the commitment of the people that you're working with. I think that obviously we've all had to struggle with this kind of online meetings. And I know that quite a few projects, like the one in Sri Lanka, we did totally online. And I think that when you're relationship building, that makes it life a lot more difficult, a lot more complicated. And very often you're having to really have painful meetings for a long time. And of course, with the technology that is kind of associated with that, in order to get to a position of trust and that they understand what we're talking about and that we understand, as Mia was saying, what we're doing and what our position is in this, so that we're not kind of the worst thing is to be speaking like throughout like a Zoom meeting at people who are totally passive and who just say yes all the time, and you have no idea what is behind that yes and what that yes really means. So I think that it sounds, I mean, it's cliche to talk about, you know, hybrid and online versus face-to-face, but I think it's just massively important that you are able to like establish meaningful relationships. And I think the only other thing I would say is that because we're working horizontally, we're not just working with academics, we're also working with students. And very often, how to build that constituency so that people are really driving something exciting that goes across the university and outside the university with the stakeholders. My kind of advantage and disadvantage is that as the 150 projects say that were generated in Southeast Asia, I was not directly involved with any of them. What I did was I kind of worked with the universities to then establish an area. Just one final mention that as an attempt, and I think the jury's still out how successful we've been. We've taken all our projects and created what we call the global network for social innovation knowledge exchange. And I know I've talked to UN in Challenges a lot, and we're still kind of developing so that all the projects that we come on board, we bring people into this, which is a kind of networking, but also a project development space and a brokerage space, and bringing people within this space with the idea of then germinating more projects that will be kind of independent of what we're doing. So this is going back to the virtual. And I think, again, I think it's a nut we still have to crack, how to drive that so it's dynamic and meaningful and sustainable. But that is a real challenge for us.
Thanks, Mark. And for any social innovators who aren't necessarily affiliated with the university, who might be on this call or might be listening later, in terms of opportunities for them to engage with the types of networks and to engage with the university to, you know, as we're talking about through the internationalization process, to collaborate with a multitude of different stakeholders within territories that they're looking to achieve global impact, is there a role that GCU can play for them?
No, absolutely. We'd be delighted to do it. And I'll put the link to the global network, which might be a kind of a starting point. I think it's got 44 countries and lots of different members, but I think that I would still say that there's more work to be done, how we can join these various organizations and individuals together. But I'll put the link in the chat so people can have a look, and obviously linking up directly with me as well.
Thanks, Mark. Thanks. And Mia, if I can come to you just to share some more just about the SFG, Sustainable Futures Global, as a standalone venture. If you can give us just a flavour of your experience so far in building a social enterprise with a global presence, just around, and especially, I think it is always of interest, any challenges that you've experienced so far.
Yes, I will give you a flavor. And Ross, you're welcome to prompt me to say anything else, because you've probably seen a lot of the journey. The flavor that I'll share is that I think it's been really, there's a lot of identity transition. I don't want to say it's an identity crisis, but there's a lot of transition that's required. And being in academia, as Mark knows, and many of you probably know, when you get to a certain point, you're so practiced at following certain expectations and aligning to certain objectives and certain value systems that it's quite a challenge to reorient yourself towards a social enterprise model. There are lots of other challenges in building the Sustainable Futures Global Network, but this latest move to a social enterprise has been a challenge for me to identify myself, as Ross was saying at the very beginning, as what my role is and who I am. Am I in an initiative that's not about the next research project, that's not about the next book or impact qualifier, but that's about building a social enterprise? So I think that's been a characteristic for me that I think is really important to acknowledge, is a huge learning curve and something around re-identifying myself as the founder or as a leader, a co-leader in a project that actually is independent from academia and the bottom lines, the industry of research, to try and extract myself from that in terms of the language that I use and the expectations that we have and the new horizon of that has been really significant, I would say, and has involved a lot of continually checking and questioning what we're doing and why we're doing it and what it's okay to say and that kind of thing. And I think, yeah, I don't know whether this is the place to talk about how challenging it is. It's really hard to a university that's doing really, really well off something doesn't want to let you go. So I don't know if this is the place to talk about that, but it's also been really politically quite challenging on a professional level, because we're trying to navigate something that overlaps sectors, that the nature of the network has always been cross-sector as well as cross-cultural and cross-disciplinary. And if we probably would have the same tension if we were trying to extract ourselves from any of one of those things, but trying to explicitly, legitimately become independent from one of those sectors has been politically really challenging, and we're not out of that woods yet. But is that okay, Ross? I'm happy to talk about any, there's so many aspects I could talk about, but we don't have very much time.
No, absolutely. No, that's great. I am interested in terms of today's session is all about mindset, and I guess that transition from or embracing SFG as a standalone entity and marrying you know, the social impact and the values that you would be bringing anyway, and marrying that with a model that requires you to be commercially viable as well, how that has been as an experience in marrying these two things together. And I think that any social enterprise or prospective social enterprise on the call could probably resonate with that too, just that, that what that marrying looks like.
There's something that it's a, you know, a being also coming from an NGO experience too, that this idea of making money and profit is kind of like a dirty word. And even as you've already experienced, Ross, in some of our network meetings around this transition, this idea that actually the gold standard is open access, no money, whether you're from Germany or whether you're from Malawi, but trying to transition that to actually equitable access. And what are the currencies that we need? And money isn't the only currency we need, but it is one of the currencies. And that has been, and that is, I think, going to be something that we need to work on collectively for a very long time. And one very quick way that we're working around that, one thing that I think has been an avenue of real growth and productivity in that space, is working with yet again new disciplines and new collaborators in our space that aren't quite so afraid of money. So working with product designers and system designers, as well as theorists and methodologists, has been really helpful to show that these things are all connected, and that actually there's a lot of financial resource out there that we can ethically take advantage of. It's been a big piece.
Yeah, thanks very much. I noticed that we've got quite a small group here. I think we can possibly move on to the Q&A section, but also, you know, if anybody wants to just introduce themselves and, you know, just reflect on anything that's been shared today or ask any questions, you know, we'd love to hear from you. If anybody would like to unmute and just share.
Thanks, Ross. Perhaps if people have got questions, I'd say please use the chat function, or like I say, like Ross says, feel free to unmute and come back in. While you're all gearing up and typing in your first questions, I was going to ask one, if I may, Ross. I was actually really interested when religion came up, but as a theology student, I guess it's a topic we don't talk about actually very much. And I think we're really seeing it play out actually currently in terms of Scottish politics in an interesting way too. It's often not talked about, and it led me to a question just in terms of how do we manage conversations about conflicts in thinking. And I was reminded of a piece of work I was actually doing during COVID again, and it was with groups in Malawi, and we were just going under lockdown, and yet we were working on a project where people were dependent on the income from the project we were running and didn't want to stop doing any of the face-to-face work. And there was a real conflict of interest between what we felt we should be doing based on our knowledge here and what we saw happening somewhere else, and how we manage that conflict in thinking. And I think we're seeing it really play out, whether it's in the religious debate, whether it's in climate change conversations. And I just wonder if there's any just thoughts or experience anyone had just about how do you manage conflicts of thinking in this environment?
I could try. It's a really general question, so I'll try and give a general answer, but that maybe some specific examples come up. I suppose we begin, or at least we strive to partnerships that are based in a certain amount of trust. So the trust that it's a safe space where we can debate, and we come at that space from very, very different perspectives and contexts. And that is very difficult to achieve. It takes different types of practices, different types of work. It takes different timelines. But that is what, in many cases, in our network, we have achieved. And it's as a result of that, the network doesn't ever stay the same. It keeps getting bigger because we don't let go of a part. You know, once a partner has come into an effective trusting relationship, then they tend to stay. So I would say we establish all of our projects and our initiatives on a basis that we are not going to come at this from the same way. We're not going to need the same things from it. And we are not going to agree about the specific details and approach of it. But what we do know is that we have to be open to each other's perspectives. And in relation to your example specifically, Naomi, I think one of the things we do really pay close attention to is the different stakes that our partnerships arrive from. And for many people, often that's primary needs. And if the stakes are primary needs, so in your example, they needed that income because of rent or food, then we have to accept the fact that we need to serve all the, you know, as a collective, we need to serve primary needs. And if that means we need not to pause this project, despite the fact that we won't be able to go out into the field because of lockdown, then we don't pause the project. We adapt what we can do in the project if somebody needs the next month's income, for example. And again, another advantage of a social enterprise, you have to define what's permissible about shifting and responding to current context. So I think this recognition, again, it comes back to partnership practices that Ross asked earlier. Just being brave enough to say, what are the stakes for you? You know, if you know that from the start, then you can deal with conflict, because for some people, the stake will be the almighty God, you know, and if you're not comfortable with that being their accountability, then probably should stop right there. But if you're comfortable with that, and if they're comfortable with the fact that you don't believe in God, then you can. And that, I make that sound like it's this universal expectation, but that excludes a lot of people. Like, that excludes a lot of people, because there are a lot of people that aren't comfortable working in that way. And I think that in a way that's helpful to understand about your own parameters or your own objectives. For us, that excludes a lot of people. And so that helps us decide what we can get involved in and what we can't.
It's about that honesty with yourself is what I'm hearing from you a little bit. Mark, I can see you're about to come in.
No, I was just going to say there are issues where it's extremely difficult. Say, for example, we've been in situations where the question of female entrepreneurship can be really challenging because of the environments where we're in, where female there's gender equality is an issue, and even when we're working with female counterparts, they're not actually as, I guess, in the same cultural situation that we are in. So then you have a dilemma of whether you compromise some of the principles that you would like to get over in order to make something more successful. And then, yeah, there are instances, we've got a female entrepreneurship project in India, and that's been very challenging.
Thank you. I think it's helpful sometimes to talk about where these really tough, sticky points can be, because it's hard actually getting this mindset and culture stuff right is hard, which is exactly, I think, why we started with this as a topic for our first webinar. It really is such a critical starting point. I'm conscious that if anyone's got any questions, please do put the chat, and I'll just give you a second to come in if you want to just step in. We've got,
sorry, Naomi, I was saying to Ross, I'm afraid I do have to leave now. So I do apologise. And it's been, but I've really enjoyed it. And if I could stay, I would. But I might be fired if I don't go. So thanks ever so much. It's been really interesting. And I'd love to stay in touch.
Thanks, Mark.
Thank you so much, Mark. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
And I think Rebecca, I think you saw you came off video for a second. I wasn't sure whether there was anything you'd like to reflect on or add.
I don't know if it's a question or just a general kind of comment, but just because I've just escaped from academia.
Oh, I should hear you speak then. How do you do that?
It's very hard, but anyway, I have. And in kind of third sector. And so I'm very aware how in academia there is a lot of incentives and investment in international work and international collaborations. And so it's been quite interesting kind of coming out of that environment and seeing that there doesn't seem to be an awful lot of investment and opportunities out with academia. And I was just wondering if that's something maybe future webinars will speak more on, and just to get more of a kind of sense of where third sector social enterprises can begin to look for support, I suppose, from the government really in projects. So that makes sense.
Thank you, Rebecca. I was going to say, it's interesting. I guess to some degree, that's a lot of the premise of the ISEO initiative in terms of groups coming together. So I think if we, I haven't got the stat actually from the latest 2021 census, which I should have, but certainly in the past, the number of social enterprises in Scotland that said they were trading internationally sat at around 6 or 7%. I think I'm correct. I've seen lots of nods. So there is, I think, an increasing interest in international work that I think we're seeing. And I think things like the Social Enterprise World Forum are helping facilitate some of that as well, just in terms of people making those connections and seeing things that they can learn. It's as much about learning from other places, I think, still in the social enterprise sector. So I think it's all still relatively new. Ross, you've obviously been involved in this for a while. Do you want to come in on that?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think the challenge is we manage some programme capital on behalf of the Scottish Government, as I said, really around supporting the internationalisation of Scottish innovation as well. So, you know, we have an investment facility that includes a starting point of grants. So we provide up to £20,000 grant funding, really to a lot around what we're exploring today is to really get a sense of the types of opportunities and for impact and, you know, commercial opportunities when they're married together, where those actually exist, as well as, so that's meant to be the kind of precursor to hopefully identifying and creating a pipeline of third sector organisations who are interested in achieving global impact, supporting them to develop robust planning, for internationalization, business planning, business modeling, financial modeling, doing the kind of market assessments, as well as understanding what the local, market dynamics are and complex problems that they're looking to achieve impact within. And as I said, that's a precursor to a loan facility, that we offer as well. So I'd be more than happy to have a conversation. And, you know, there is more funding within the social enterprise ecosystem as well. So yeah, more than happy to have a conversation about what those opportunities look like.
Thank you, Ross. And I've just put in the link to the contact form just in terms of getting in touch with ISEO, in terms of if there's anything in terms of that one-to-one support that's there. It's very much done in a kind of partnership and signposting approach. So what we're trying to do is make it so that for anyone that is interested, either in terms of more work in Scotland from an international perspective or Scottish organisations wanting to develop international programmes or products or services, that actually we can either be helping them directly or signposting them to the right places, because it is actually tough sometimes to know where to go when you're trying to balance that impact and commercial sense all in one, I think. So do get in touch, I guess, if you've got any thoughts or if there's anything you're looking to develop. The team are here to help. So that's partly what we're doing. And I think, again, sessions in terms of future webinars, we're really open to hearing if there's particular things that you want us to be running sessions on. Bung it in the chat, because the program's there to help people that want to do this work. So the more we can respond and listen ourselves to what people need, the better the webinar program would be than always trying to make assumptions. I think we've heard a lot today about the importance of listening. So it's for us to do that as well. Are there any more questions just from anyone else in the session? We've got a few minutes left before we wrap up.
Just a thank you for Naomi. It's been really interesting. I've learned a lot. It's great to know about the organization.
Thank you, Mia. It's I've loved today's conversation. It's been really interesting. And like I say, I think a great way to have started off these webinars, really talking about culture and mindset. I think it's critical, even if you're operating an enterprise in your own community, that you listen first. So even more so when we're trying to do this on an international scale, I think. So I think even if you're not trying to develop an international project, there's a lot you can learn from the conversation about culture and mindset, actually, that's valid whatever you're doing. So thank you very much for joining us. And what I'm going to do is leave the session open as well for a few minutes. If people want to follow any of the links that are on, there's nothing worse than the webinar ending and suddenly go, I didn't write it down, and they've closed it. So we will keep it going. Ross, do you want to just finish off today with some final words?
Yeah, I'd just like to thank everybody for coming along today. And as Naomi said, this is just the first in a series. And I think we're trying to unlock some new conversations that aren't necessarily just the same as, what you'd usually expect from this kind of session. So I think we've talked a lot about quite a lot of complex things, but just for anybody to reach out to share any more reflections or to reach out for support as well. And, we're always happy to hear more from everybody. So, yeah, thank you. Thanks for joining.